There are very few destinations in the lower 48 where you can find yourself hiking through the clouds one day and lost in a sagebrush desert the next. Wildlife abound, critters of all shapes and sizes gravitate towards the life-giving watersheds, cutting their way through the expansive ranges. If you can properly place your fly, there is a good chance you'll be able to witness every color under the sun manifested in wild trout swimming free. But be warned, these experiences, they never come free of charge. Unforeseen obstacles will bring uncertainty to any backcountry adventure. If you come prepared and are willing to be flexible with plans, there's a good chance you'll be able to experience it all to its fullest. This is going to be a few days fly fishing in Idaho. Chapter 1. That's a lot of frogs.
It'll definitely help you catch more fish.
If I ain't remembered it by now, it's not important.
It's not important enough.
Waving the white flag to pre-trip packing anxiety, we emerged from the basement apartment in Boise and set our sights north towards McCall. In the never-ending race against the sun, we had a bit of blacktop between us and the trail. Even in the dark of dawn, semi-trucks and mountain town speed reductions did their best to slow us down. So every now and then, burning rubber and Tokyo drifting around the corner was in order to meet the time deadlines. Winning the race against the light, we saddled up in the dark with no time to waste. Blindly maneuvering this parking lot made me second guess my now fuzzy memory. And after all, it had been about 4 years and many adventures in between since I've been back to this very spot. But once we buckled down on the trail and linked up with the old forest road, there was no question. The growing light illuminated the scenery around us and I could finally envision a much younger version of myself making this same trudge not so long ago.
Oh, imagine doing this. But with maybe like six inches of snow and in snowshoes.
You do that?
They say fortune favors the bold, but the line between bold and downright stupid is thin and awfully flimsy. So 4 years ago, while I was making this ill-advised trek up a snowy mountain, the new Juice WRLD album was stuck in my head while the Golden State Warriors were marching towards yet another NBA Finals run. Snowshoes in tow, cabin fever fueled this trudge up to a very frozen lake, and clearly, itchy palms got the best of me. Dumb in the moment, but beneficial in the end, I was able to time open water just about perfect. McCall has about a dozen or so trophy lakes in and around the area, and Fish and Game, they manage them for quality fish. What does this mean? That means big fish and a lot of them too. May and June, depending on the year, can be some of the most electric high mountain lake fishing you'll see all year long. And even though it was now rounding off on early September, we still had a caster's chance that we could find a fish or two in the wake of the morning light. So Louis Lake made for the perfect first stop on our trip hit list. Our pace was rather toxic at this point, and we were able to grab our first glimpse at the lake before the sun even hit the water.
Yep. Stop number one. Here we are. What do you think, man? Not bad, huh?
Yeah, I just saw one rise over on the left.
Over there?
Yeah. Could have been a wind, though, too.
That would be nuts. I don't know if we could. How hard it would be. Yeah, I think this might be our best bet. Wow, this is so low. This is wild. Otherwise, I was thinking on that side. Yeah. It would be either this side right here or that side right there.
Because I bet over there. Actually, I don't know.
Do you want to go over there?
No, I was just saying, like, I don't know if, like, how deep it would be in between the island and the shore, but it's pretty flat going in, so it's not like it drops off.
Mm-hmm.
My back is sweaty.
With this being the first of many stops on the day, we got rigged up and got right to work. Our expectations, they were holding at a measured rate, but we were still excited to give this like a crack. But before we get our lines wet, it might be worth introducing my partner in crime for this trip. This is Nick. Internet friends are a weird concept that seem to endlessly concern and confuse my loved ones from the Midwest. Prior to this, Nick and I have never met in person, and not really possible when he lives all the way over in Massachusetts, but through various talks on the Fly All Season Discord, Instagram, and then actually talks on the phone, his resume, it was more than qualified. And if he's not chasing wild trout upstate, he's conquering the highest peaks in the area and working out like an absolute demon. So truth be told, I felt like I already knew him pretty well before I scooped him up at the airport. Plus, he'd never been west of the Mississippi, and I informed him that that needed to change. So with certain time restraints working against us, we managed to whip up a cheeky Labor Day Lake Loop backpacking trip somewhere in the Payette National Forest. The original goal was to bounce around to a few different lake chains and chase western fish like cutthroat and grayling. But, like another Mike I know once said, everyone has a plan until they get punched in the mouth.
I think I might try and, I see a stepping stone, I might just try and stand out in the water.
Yeah, I mean, there's a rock right there.
Yeah. I don't want to get too close to you.
I warned Nick that a trophy lake like this would have seen a lot of pressure this season, so this was only meant to be a quick stop. With an hour being our max time given to this lake, the hope of picking off a nice fish or two might have been a bit ambitious. With the low water, coupled with the arrival of other anglers, our chances were starting to look rather slim.
Yeah, I don't know. I would hate to have to set up shop. Oh, rats. That sucks. Thought it was a fish.
All around the lake, the air was starting to warm as the glow of the sunrise wrapped its way around the mountains. The swing of temperatures brought on an audible chop that distorted our once glassy lake. Not seeing anything around the next bend worthy of wasting time, the new goal was to find greener pastures. Our morning had started off with a blistering pace between the drive and the initial hike, so it was time to enjoy an overdue breakfast and some much needed hydration before we slung the packs and headed out.
All right, step one, on to the next one. Let's go.
Our path pointed up and it was once again time to suffer. This route was by no means the most friendly to hikers, but it was by far our best option given the circumstances put in front of us. I will say this portion of the trail allows for some amazing views of McCall in the greater area as you climb to the peak. It was kind of a shame the Four Corners fire had popped up just last week outside of Cascade because the still active burn obscured most of the familiar landmarks on the horizon. But once we hit the crest, we left McCall and the shroud of smoke behind us and it was time to find Rapid.
Oh wow, beautiful. So that must be Twin Peaks right there. That is, but that's, I think, Boulder down there, and we're gonna be just over.
Salmon bound single engine soared overhead, and I have no doubt they were carrying eager anglers looking for that backcountry bite. As the drone faded off into the distance, we were able to find some reprieve from our uphill battle that we had fought through most of the morning. Smooth sailing would save our legs and lungs as we pushed past the halfway mark. I kept a keen eye on Nick for most of the hike, but at this point, it was clear he was absolutely crushing it. There was never a question of the physical ability side of this, it was more so the elevation that I wondered about. Even just a few thousand increase can affect folks, especially with minimal time to acclimate. But as we hit a low spot in the trail, a babbling stream would be the perfect place to make our second stop of the day. Cold water and hopping frogs was more than enough to keep us entertained before making our final push to camp.
All right, so we're halfway to home. We're getting there at least.
Yeah, getting good frog content for my herpetology page.
I wonder what kind of frogs these are.
Little baby guy. Some sort of alpine pickerel frog.
He doesn't
frog.
Like spinning around.
Nah, he's on that gyro shit. He's on that gyro. He's like, nah, man.
He's a gyro guy.
Fresh prints in the dust let us know that we were certainly not alone on this very popular holiday weekend. It's hard to tell the actual number of individuals in and around the area, but with different boot tread and size peppering the dusty path, we had to swallow the tough pill that we would most likely be sharing this lake. Reading the writing on the wall, our hunches were confirmed when we neared the shore and saw a few established camps with folks already out in the water fishing. This was no big deal because the lake itself, it was big enough to spread out, and that's exactly what we did. There were plenty of sites further down the shore, and this one, it was going to be the perfect fit. At least for one night.
Yeah, we can finagle two tents in here, I bet. No question. Well, good deal, man. We've arrived.
This is my only worry is this tree right here. Pretty much.
Well, that's still got moss on it.
Yeah.
Scanning the canopy for dead trees, we began the tedious process of disassembling the organized disaster that is a well-stuffed sack. Between fishing stuff, camera junk, and the necessary camp items, my poor pack is an absolute clown car. Luckily, this far into the season, this task was starting to become second nature. Once the tent was up, sleeping pad, bag, and pillow were tucked in snug, I got to working on moving the fire pit closer to our sitting log. For convenience sake and comfort, this would allow us easy access to both. Everything was coming together nice and tidy for both our setups, so it was time to complete the last task on the docket. As frustrating as it can be sometimes, hanging up the bear bag is one of the more important bear safety tactics you can use in the backcountry. We had packed in all sorts of smelly human foods, and old Yogi Bear, he didn't need to come sniffing around our camp.
I think we can make an honest lady out of this lake. Do a whole circuit around her and see if we can't find a fish or two bumming around.
Getting rigged up for the second time today was objectively faster just because we had most of it out already. But this is where the nosedive disaster of our day started to make its first drastic tilt down. Unaware of what we were to find at the second lake, we mistook this family of spruce grouse for a serendipitous meeting and most of all, a good omen.
Must not have a whole lot of natural predators.
You weird mountain
chicken. Oh, there's babies down there.
I hear him. In hindsight, these weird mountain chickens were merely the welcoming party to our day's demise. Or at least I'm gonna blame it on them.
We can see you.
Yeah. I just want to get a look at the water and see what the hell is going on. It's pretty shallow. Yeah, right there. I don't like that looked like, oh, bubbles probably. That was, but.
There's a couple 4 inches over here. Huh? There's a couple 4 inches over here stacked up.
Those were, but it was just, there was a splash to it. And the rings went out pretty wide.
You don't like the leech all that much. I got a couple follows, but that's about it.
More frogs?
Little trout.
Oh.
I had spotted a few tiny trout-like figures squiggling in the faint current of a micro inlet stream. I'm talking 12 inches across and maybe 2 inches deep. This was barely a trickle coming down the mountain, and it's hard to imagine anything could even swim up this far from the lake, let alone live in it. And being this small, there's no good way to properly identify these fish, but with previous docking records being our only resource, I had to assume these were some sort of wild remnant population of West Slope cutthroat from decades earlier. But with most of our flies doubling the size of these micro trout, this was a major red flag. A light sprinkle briefly hit our side of the lake, and we both felt like something was just off. Normal high alpine trout lakes, they just don't act like this.
Spot, but yeah, I don't know. If there are big fish, which I think there probably are, they're not in here.
The faint echo of an earlier conversation with some of the campers on the other side of the lake started to get louder in my head. They said, yeah, fishing was a lot better last year. Can't seem to find anything this time around. They seemed to be convinced that there was some sort of fish kill that happened over the winter. And as Nick and I casted aimlessly into the growing wind, I was afraid they might be right.
You can hear the ground moving. And it says toads. Lots of toads.
No fish, but lots of toads.
Lots of toads.
And unfortunately, as crowded as this is, I feel like that plan B spot, Hum Lake, it might just be just as bad as far as people goes. I don't know, Labor Day's tough.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
But
working hard. We're not hardly working.
We're getting our asses whooped right now. That's what's happening.
It was way too early in the trip to already be activating Plan C, but we were desperate at this point. As the crow flies, Summit Lake wasn't all that far from Rapid, and the terrain was mostly open and free of deadfall. With the hopes of better fishing, we made it up to this isolated bowl with just enough time for an evening session.
It just depends. Let's get a look at it before we start getting sad. We just need one good deep drop off. That's it. Just one good drop off. I'm not seeing as many frogs, which is good.
Now, on initial looks, quantity was lacking, but overall frog quality was at an all-time high. Two absolute units were lazily breaststroking their way along the lake shore. They could not have given less of a rat's ass about our presence, and something tells me they don't run into a whole lot of predators this far up.
So you said there was a couple down there chasing your leech?
Yeah. Every time I cast it, basically.
That's very neat that there are grayling in here. That's very cool. Takes are really weird. I think I still see him down there.
Try and get out to that guy.
Excuse me? Oh shit! He went after the chubby.
I'm gonna scream.
Ah!
Leave it, just let it sit, let it sit.
He went back down towards the log. That was funny, he went after that a couple times.
This is definitely the more structured side. That's quite the drop off right there. It's just a matter of casting. Good luck.
I hope anyone out there watching can understand that we threw the damn kitchen sink at this little lake. Between the both of us, we must have tied on a dozen different rigs, all in varying sizes, weights, and depths, and we got nothing. Between the weird weather and the howling wind, Nick and I were both at our wits' end, wondering how it all could have gone so wrong. I tossed a few more hopeless casts into the wind, fully convinced that this day was over. I mean, everything up until this point was trending in that direction anyway. I'm not kidding when I say, on what was probably the last cast, I was surprised by a slight bump on the end of my nymph. And I want everyone watching to pay attention here and understand that this silly thing we call fly fishing is at its roots still a blood sport. The stocked grayling, it didn't get dropped. It wasn't out of the water long. It wasn't bleeding, and I certainly didn't manhandle it to get a shot. These are fragile fish by nature, and the shock and stress alone of being caught was enough to really mess it up. Thigh high, I sat and cradled this poor fish for the better part of 10 minutes or more, and outside of a few weak tail kicks, it showed no sign of recovery. I don't know if that was because of the oxygen in the water, or just the stress of being caught, but we decided the only thing we could do is leave it in the lake, hoping that time would help revival, but it looked grim. Nothing about this was worth it. Killing fish is never the intention, and truth be told, I would have much rather taken the skunk for the day. Most folks, they don't like showing the sour realities that come with this thing we call fly fishing. And I just think it's important to acknowledge the impact an angler has on its quarry, no matter how responsible you claim to be. The triple scoop strikeout Sunday that was today's adventure was crowned with a dead fish cherry on top and a sinking pit in my stomach. Needless to say, this was a very frustrating hike. It's back to glass. Camp.
Oh, you're saying that
I could see anything.
Yeah.
Once we got back, the hurting in our hearts could be put on the shelf for a bit while we addressed the sharper pain coming from our stomachs. After a grinder day like this, a luxurious backpacking dinner was in order.
How much?
One cup, perfect.
There we go. A trip is?
What the hell are these fucking?
Everything self-contained.
Hand away from the fire.
And that ain't half bad. Chef Nick in the building. Hell yeah.
I've never tasted so good in my whole life.
It's kind of amazing. Give us a rating.
No fish out of 10.
What about the ramen at least?
Ramen, that's like a 13 out of 7.
I agree.
After we let the belly stretching feast settle for just a second, we made our way back down to the shores of Rapid Lake. Our fingers were crossed and our eyes were peeled. We were convinced that the setting sun might bring out some bigger fish who would let their presence be known through the rippling dimples on the settled surface. We should have known better because it was just more of the same. Tiny trout were eating microscopic morsels only to be disturbed by more leaping frogs along the shore. Agreeing that this fish-focused channel should be scrapped completely and changed to frog all season, we retreated back to the tents to finish out the night. Nick dove in to some pocket-sized Tolkien text while I bashed my brains in the squishy needle-covered ground under my tent. This day could not have gone much worse, and I was equal parts guilty that I dragged my new friend into this and confused about the failed research. All the literature and previous experience pointed towards this loop being nothing short of a home run. But this froggy uppercut came out of nowhere and hit me right in the mouth. Don't get it twisted, I love frogs just as much as the next guy and, well, no, I take that back. I have an above average appreciation for frogs, but at this point, there begins to be a conflict of church and state. The bittersweet side of leaping figures is enough to drive any amphibian ally over the edge, and to be fair to the frogs, it wasn't their fault. Frogs are gonna frog. Especially when there's a lack of aquatic predators like trout. Recent shifts in high mountain lake management by Idaho Fish and Game could be part of the reason we struck out. And I should say, this is a complex issue that deserves a lot more research, so definitely go see Idaho Fish and Game for that management plan. But native amphibians are finally starting to get more attention in favor of non-native and non-reproducing populations of salmonids that used to dominate most of these bodies of water. Now, the shift in management doesn't really explain the confusing stocking reports or the tiny trout swimming around, but that might be a mystery for another day. But folks, let this research mistake be a cautionary tale to any and all out there watching. My reliance on previous experiences stifled my diligence when it came to trip planning. A simple call to Fish and Game or the McCall Ranger District could have drastically changed the outcome of this first day. This was a massive oversight on my part and basically cost us the first day of an already tight schedule. Before the last embers of our campfire were snuffed out, Nick and I both agreed that things had to change. Even if that meant packing up and completely shifting game plans. Chapter 2, Double Back. This is never a situation you want to find yourself in.
Good morning, sir.
Cold hands fumbled with dew-covered gear as what was left of camp was blindly stuffed back into an unorganized backpack. This late into the season, every new sunrise brought the backcountry closer and closer to an inevitable winter.
I thought I was seeing 2021.
Really?
Yeah. I'll have to go back and check, but I thought I was seeing pretty recent stockings because those grayling weren't big. I don't know how much they grow in an environment like this, but I can't imagine it's... well... I can't imagine they stay that small.
Like the hopes of finding fish at these two lakes, I gave our once hot fire a solid stamping before it was time to turn tail and tackle the trail.
There's nothing rising. Not a single rise.
Without so much as a crack in the glassy face of Rapid Lake, this galvanized our final decision to seek for greener pastures. In my years of experience with most any high mountain lake system, this should have been a rolling boil of fishy dimples probing the surface for breakfast. A few deep breaths were required, but with a new day and our initial frustrations now well at our backs, it was time to put all our focus on Plan B. B for Boulder, that is. This lake was always meant to be our fail-safe option. I just didn't think we'd have to pull the ripcord to our reserve chute this soon. With the most up-to-date stocking reports and a healthy bit of personal experience, we could safely assume this lake had plenty of fish. Plus, compared to the rest, this lake was massive in both size and depth. There'd be plenty of room to spread out if there were other anglers, and more than deep enough to protect holdover fish populations from winter kills. Even knowing this, a few red flags stuck out right away once we hit the lakeshore. First and foremost, frog all season was back, or in this case, just toad all season. The other, and by far more pressing issue, was the overall lake levels. You can easily see the normal high water mark on the bank. We were able to use the exposed lake bed to hike around most of this lake unobstructed, which made for really easy travel, so kinda hard to complain about that. But with normal levels, we would have been neck deep in the water, not speeding along to our first spot. But before we could get too in our heads and psych ourselves out about the potential issues with this lake, Nick pointed out a suspicious bobbing head dancing around in the middle of the lake.
He's got like the white chin.
Yeah, I think that's an otter.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Never seen one of those before.
A little wildlife sighting. He's munching all the trout.
Dude, he's just having a ball. He's just like swimming in a circle.
Yeah, he's probably getting an idea of what the hell are you guys. He says, are you going to catch me breakfast? Or what?
Now, I might be going out on a limb here, but if my nature math adds up, if there were otters, there had to be fish. This was the first and only otter I've ever seen in a high alpine lake, which was kind of a shock if I have to be honest. But something that didn't surprise me was fresh bear prints going down the lakeshore in a rather healthy pile of scat. So if anyone out there was curious, it turns out bears do. We used this healthy dump as our X marks the spot and decided this jutting rock formation was the best spot to start our second day's campaign.
I didn't quite like that spot back there. And this is, I think, significantly better than where we need to be.
Oh, that was a bite. That was a bite. That was a bite. That was 110% a bite. Leech, yeah. Oh, I've got a cruiser. I've got a cruiser. He might see me. Oh, here he comes. Bingo. Hey, I've got my net up there. Let's go, dude.
Oh, black shit. Leech.
Black leech. Well, he went after both. That's a west slope.
All right, there he goes. See ya, buddy.
It can be something so subtle, just like a tick, tick, tick.
Yeah.
You gotta really focus on that streamer set. Why, they are coming up like crazy over there, huh? Okay, there's one cruising right here. Can you see him? He's coming off to the left. Oh, right there. He's chasing that one. He's moving to my right now. He's out in that sandbank. Strip. That was quite the frenzy, huh? 2-3 right in a row.
It was so nice to see that we had finally made our first proper decision of this entire trip. Clearly, these cruising fish were using this rocky structure and drop-off point to hunt for their breakfast. The action itself, it would kind of ebb and flow, but it would never be all that long in between bites. Having a decent sense that it would just be a matter of time and proper placement, I had a feeling Nick would be breaking his skunk very soon.
I've had quite a few more bites and I had another fish. They seem to like the cast out count 10 cadence. I had one take on the drop, which was kind of funny. I didn't get to get him in though.
I'm coming, dude. Keep him tight. Come on, baby.
Oh my god.
Yep, it may look like a rainbow, but I promise you that is a red slope cut through.
Yeah. I saw the pink on the side and I was like, no.
Yeah. Only took us four legs.
Four legs.
Jeez Louise.
Third time's the charm? Nah.
Nah.
Fourth time's the charm, baby.
Beautiful, man. So beautiful.
Yeah, that's a west slope through and through.
So let's do this for me. Deep breath in, deep breath out. Deep breath in, deep breath out. Good stuff, sir. Good stuff.
Dude, I was getting really like down on myself too because I spooked like three fish even roll casting.
Yeah.
I saw him like shoot out. I'm like, fuck.
Well, I think this chop's gonna be with us for the rest of the day.
I think it's better than having a glass because they won't see us as much.
I wouldn't even say worrying about a roll cast or whatever. You can just probably like what? Yeah. Just whip it because they're not gonna know the difference, man.
The nagging skunk had finally left the building for the both of us, but while the door was slightly cracked, a nasty gust had snuck its way through, and calm water was now a thing of the past. Labored roll casts and low profiles would now be the new norm for the rest of our day.
It's still frog all season over here.
Dozens of little eyes were peeping through the lakeshore grass as we started to shift our approach further down the lakeshore. Unrelenting chop took my focus away from the lake for just a bit, and I managed to spot another fish-eating friend on the opposite side of the lake.
Right, what's that? Oh, osprey. That's the osprey. So you saw him dive down and get one?
Yeah.
That's super cool. That's our competition right there, man.
First otters, now osprey. These are all context clues given by nature to let us anglers know we were definitely in the right neighborhood, and just as I began to think the morning bite had mysteriously burned off, we got hit with another fishy flurry of action.
I mean, he followed that right to the boat.
There we go. Thank you, sir. Well, you're beautiful little West Slope, aren't you there, sir?
West Slope cutties are one of the more underrated species of cutthroat, at least in my opinion. They seem to take second fiddle to some of the more well-known species like your Yellowstones, Colorado, and even Bonneville, and I can certainly see how that might happen. They oftentimes don't get nearly as big, and their colors, they just aren't as revered as others. But some of these lake cutties we found today had the most vibrant coloration compared to basically any other fish I found in my summer travels. I find that West Slopes have a smattering of blue dots that contrast perfectly with the reds and greens of their body and belly. With sparse speckling and rosy red cheeks, how can you not fall in love with the look of a healthy West Slope? It always seems to go this way. I call it the curse of the camera. But the second I go to record something else, Nick hooks up with another great fish.
Sitting here twiddling my thumbs and my man's got a fish. It's a good one.
Nice.
Yeah, solo retrieve was it. And a roll cast.
Over there. Yeah, that red slash is beautiful.
Hell yeah, man.
With a handful of fish between the both of us now, it might be worth explaining the flies we're using for this session.
And this is gonna be very meta, but this is, very much the future and the past Mike talking here. I'm gonna have the video on how to tie it down below, but this is many, many months before this trip ever even happened. This is how I prep, looking months and months down the road. So, when we're talking about the two-tone leech, this is a very, very simple stillwater pattern that I've kind of developed and started using over the past like 2 or 3 years. You know, when I explore the mountain west, one of my favorite all-time things to do is high mountain lakes. I mean, it's hard to compare. It's so much freaking fun. But when we're talking about these lake systems, leeches are an extremely important part of a lot of these fish's diets. And you look at leeches, you look at crane fly larvae, you can even, you know, go as far as juvenile trout. This profile is extremely important, and I've caught so many dang fish in these lake systems off of patterns just like this. This one, in particular, two-tone leech, very simple on a balanced jig-style hook with just two different types of rapid zonker. Nothing too complicated here. I mean, you don't have to do the dubbing loop. It's not necessary to make this fly, but it does make it a little bit more slim and sleek, and I think it looks good. But I don't think the fish fair, I don't think they care, you know? But yeah, hopefully we can catch a few more, and hopefully you got a better idea of how this pattern is tied and why we're using.
If we leave at one, we're gonna give us an hour and a half to get up the mountain, so that's 2:30.
and then 2.5 hours to get home because of traffic. So 3, 4, 5, and an hour for food. 6.
Yeah.
Somewhere, some stop along the way. So 1 o'clock is our point.
And we'll get service. We can look. We'll have it down with the car.
Yeah.
Or, I mean, I'm not, honestly, tin roof banks.
I'd run back tin roof. And we know we could get that quick. We could get it to go. We could call in an order on the way home. Just run in real quick, pay for it.
After a quick snack on the rocks, we got right back to work fan casting off our rock point. We had both found success using different methods and strip techniques in order to find the fish. And I would say at this point, our confidence, it was trending upwards.
Oh, buddy, this is a good fish. I got mine. I got mine handy. This is a nice fish.
Nice fish, man. You are red, red, red. Wow. You are very much appreciated, sir. Wowza. That's easily best one of the day.
Well, he came out. That super sucks.
That's what I get. It's what I get, I spend.
That back-to-back action was a great way to start things up again, but things seemed to quiet down afterwards. This was no big deal, because at this point, we had a really nice system in the works. Catch a few, move down the bank. Cast for a few more minutes, and repeat the process. Not super glamorous or technical by any means, but we found this to be the most effective method. So boulder bouncing our way down the bank, Nick posted up on a new rocky outcropping while I cast it into the shallow bay. I gotta say, I was lucky I heard the holler over the howling winds, but it sounded like Nick was on, so I hurried over.
Another one?
There we go.
On the nymph. On the nymph.
So you put a trailer nymph behind it?
Sure.
Nice. Small?
Little guy.
Yeah.
He's pretty.
No, smaller nymph.
Oh, kinda. It's like a 14. Not tiny.
You can slim it. There you go. Perfect. You got a great shot. See him back.
All right, now I need some fishing arts, bro.
Yes, sir.
Good stuff.
Good stuff.
Now we can say we're catching fish.
We're finally catching fish?
Now, I should have just stuck around because it wasn't more than a few minutes later and Nick had stuck into another great west load.
On the nymph again?
No, this one was on the...
The leech?
Yeah, now we're catching fish.
Yeah, I love how that one almost has no spots.
Yeah.
They don't really get that. Here you go. Still so nice, man. I'll give some knocks to that. So yeah, we're leaving, right? We're leaving in an hour, right?
We're leaving in an hour.
No matter how far we pushed down the bank, we could not escape the wind. The surface of the water, it was affected. I mean, clearly, that should go without saying. But it's important to note that things were just as tumultuous underwater as well. Sight fishing, it was pretty much out of the question at this point, and blind casting was all we could do to drum up the occasional bite. Luck played a huge part right here, because this fish hit my leech no less than 3 times before I gave him a proper streamer set. The blushing cheeks and vibrant red stripe running down its side made it a strong candidate for the prettiest fish of the day, at least in my book.
Get any more?
I had a decent one for the drive.
Damn.
I think I set it like a brook trout, so like right away.
Yeah.
Cut there, you're supposed to wait a little bit.
Yeah, they like to sit there, look at it, give it a little lick, kiss it, and they eat it.
He came clean out of the water for it, but.
Oh, that's cool. I got one more down there.
Oh yeah.
Pretty one.
Whoa.
Don't break a toe. Can't afford to break a toe, not right now.
Huh?
I guess I'm an idiot and I'm casting, trying to get it out there, and the fish eats it. Oh wow, I just did a negative cast right there. Perfect. A negative cast, that's what you want.
You on? Do you have the net? I got your net. Oh my gosh, double, double,
yes.
Double.
Oh, come on, dude, get yours in. Oh, it's a great fish. Oh my god, we did it. Cuddy dubby.
The cuddy double.
The cuddy double.
The cuddy double.
Fishy knucks?
Big time fishy knucks, dude. Hell yeah. That's too funny, man.
All right.
The absolute coolest, dude. That was so sick. That could not have gone any better. The cuddy double fourth quarter.
Oh,
God, man. Do we leave? Because
so
you're getting bites just there. I was getting bites just there.
I will say the bites are few and far between for me out there.
Yeah.
Like it's every dozen, 20 casts.
Yeah. Ratio's not great. I mean, we're right on time. To keep to original plan. So yeah, I guess we ought to.
It'd be cool to see
something else.
Yeah, like if we can find like a river or something.
I think
ending on this note after a day yesterday, I think it's smart to end on a high.
I think so too, man. But it's tough. It's definitely tough. It's closing time.
Think of the whole rig.
Yeah.
Try, because I mean, I'm game for the bank.
Big rib. Oh, yeah. All right, brother man, you ready?
I'll let you know in a second.
Finding consistent success at Boulder Lake made it really hard to even think about walking away. The pain of the pack and pull of the heart pointed towards this being our best option if we were just focused on quantity of fish. This wonderful session was just enough to quell the desire for fish, momentarily at least, but the glitter of unknowing on the horizon was a distraction needed to point our gaze in the opposite direction of this fish-filled lake. Was this dumb? Yeah, maybe. Now, I never said either of us are rocket scientists because you know what they say about leaving fish to find fish. But since Nick had never been out west, we both agreed it'd be really cool to see as much of what it had to offer as possible, more than just high alpine lakes at least. Our final decision to leave made even more sense in the moment because our original game plan was more than belly up at this point and we had run out of options.
That's what I'm saying, that's a big fish.
Just two of them.
Yeah, that's a very nice fish. That's what you want.
Not being out of the woods yet, literally and figuratively, some slightly sketchy rock shuffling and boulder hopping was in order to get us back to the actual trail. It was more than touch and go for a bit, especially with heavy packs throwing off our equilibrium. This right here is why Nick and I trained so hard in the off season. Weight training and crazy cardio pays off in droves when faced with obstacles like this in the backcountry. Luckily, the rock wall didn't last all that long and we shook off the nerves of some close slips and buckled down on the trail. Once we maneuvered our way around the crowds of lazy Labor Day sunbathers down by the dam, the day was all downhill from here. And in this case, I mean downhill in a very literal sense. We were running on a tight schedule and we could basically run down the backside of this mountain while elevation plummeted in the direction of my dormant truck. Anxious talks of tomorrow's adventure, anime, NBA, and most of all, what we would be eating for dinner helped pass the time on the trail, and before we knew it, we saw the gravel clearing of a very crowded parking lot.
Alrighty, sir. Here's to that adventure. Let's,
one down, one to go.
Cut it at halftime.
Yeah.
We got one more half to go.
With our sights set south, I was slightly sad to see the valley of my memory shrouded by smoke. I was up this direction 1 week prior, and that's when the Four Corners fire got its initial start. It would seem as though the local fire crews were still fighting this beast tooth and nail. Seeing entire mountainsides on fire, it was a rather raw reminder of how wild and unforgiving this land can truly be. But leaving the plume of smoke behind us, we beelined it to the best taco joint this side of the Rio Grande and hit the apartment to research as much potential water before exhaustion and full bellies would lull us into an early sleep. Chapter 3. Flip the script.
I'm working for the trip.
We left the bombshell crater that was my Boise apartment early on day 3 and hit the ground with the pedal down. From our hours of searching through the proverbial hay bale that was Idaho trout waters, we managed to sift up something that roughly resembled a needle. Gathering up the breadcrumbs from this lead, we pointed our compass east and began the search for something lost in the big magic valley. For a few hours, the path followed desolate rangeland that bordered the mountains on the north and the desert scrub to the south. Bales of beige and bovine herds were all we saw until we hit the first turn, which shot straight north towards a fertile valley. Sleepy little mountain towns were still rubbing the tired out of their eyes as we quietly passed through. These kind of towns, they always make me chuckle. Small ranch houses and modest storefronts are surrounded by extravagant mansions and private jets of all things. You're just as likely to see a rusted out pickup parked next to the Tesla on Main Street. And obviously this isn't always the case, but Nick and I, we laugh because we both knew our tourist status, it really didn't help this strange dichotomy. But this feeling, it wouldn't last long because the mountains raised up out of the land and we lost any sign of civilization. We were left with nothing more than a narrow mountain pass framed in the dirty windshield. Dusty back roads and grazing cattle finally led us to the valley we were looking for, but foreshadowing Forest Service signs let us know we might not be here long.
Feel the rhythm, feel the rhyme, brother. Get out those sore vibes. We've arrived.
This right here is the beauty of a state like Idaho. Yesterday, Nick and I woke up to the smell of pine and the sight of deep blue lakes, and now today, wafts of sagebrush tickled the nose while the sound of moving water perked our ears. With the big sun shining down strong and not another car to be seen, it would seem as though we had successfully found ourselves lost. Fingers crossed, it would all pay off.
Go down and around, honestly. If you want to go down that way and come around, easy does it. One just came up towards the back of the pool.
Got it.
So really work your way up.
Oh, nice cast.
I was more behind the one that I saw.
Okay.
We couldn't pick off any of the rising fish out of this pool, and as we continued upstream, it seemed as though we had ventured up the wrong section. This far up in the system, willows choked the banks, and narrow offshoots, they started to splinter their way through the river valley. This made fishable water harder to find, and casting lanes nearly impossible to maneuver. Our scanning of satellite maps had led us astray, but at least we knew there were fish here. Doubling back to the truck, under the watchful eye of the valley cattle would be no big deal at all, because there was too much day left to strike out and plenty of water downstream to find some fish.
Probably right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Probably over here.
They can. It does just have to be something we kind of play around with a little bit. We should probably cross here though.
Just because of the glare, I can't tell, but is it deep?
Yeah, it should be deep
enough.
Can we get him? Yeah, I got him. Oh, you get out of there, you son of a bitch.
Get his head up.
You! There we go.
Yellowstone cutty.
A very fine specimen indeed.
The bottom dropper, what was that?
A little crapper John.
Yeah, he's got some chompers. Now he may be stocked. So you see his fins?
Yeah.
They look a little beat up. So I'm not quite sure if he's, he's got a nice, pretty robust adipose. He could just be an old fish too.
Cool. That's the one thing I don't get. Like, everyone assumes any fish with a beat up fin is stocked.
I know, but it's very proto, like yeah. the pectorals being yeah. busted like that and his dorsal.
So cover, we need to find cover.
Putting the pieces together, we blazed a path upstream, looking for any water that had a sliver of structure to it. Getting around the willow clusters and looking around the next bend, we found the perfect spot and Nick wasted no time.
We can work this line up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Nice cast. That's it, that's it, that's it, that's it.
No.
Easy does it. Easy does it. I'll get your net. Get his head. Don't horse him though. Don't horse him. You still got that dropper on that could break your line. Oh my gosh, this is a nice fish. This is a really nice fish. Where'd he go? Where'd he go? Shit. Where'd he go? Okay. This is turning into a hot mess. Oh no, Nick. Oh no. Oh no.
Right, arch this side to side. Okay. Come on.
Woo! That's a Western fish, baby!
Yes, sir!
Woo! Hopper muncher and all.
Dude, I watched. He came up.
Holy
so
cow.
It. It is my
That's a f- fish, dude. Let's Holy go! Shit. Woo!
Oh my god.
That's a big fish, bro. Oh. Yo.
Dude, I watched you come out and follow the hopper.
That's a big fish. On my lands, Nick. That's the fish we come for.
With some gnarled teeth and thick shoulders, you could tell this was an older fish. Nose to tail, this was a phenomenal representation of a Yellowstone cutthroat trout. Opal cheek plates blushed in the sun, and the speckled yellow belly led to an absolutely stunning tail. I could not have been more ecstatic to see Nick with this beautiful fish. That right there, that is a fish worth traveling all this way to find.
That is what you want, baby.
The hopper munch, baby. We made it. The cutthroat of dreams. I can go home happy. I'm good.
That was epic, man.
Dude,
that
was oh my god.
Epic. We need to get some big
the
fishy
hopper munch. The fishy hopper munch.
This was such a huge weight lifted off our shoulders because not only did Nick break the skunk, but that hopper munching fish was definitely in the upper tier of quality for this entire system. Needless to say, anything else we found today would be a massive scoop of gravy added on top.
Yeah, I'm thinking so. I'd like that if I were a little fish in there.
Really just him under all of that?
He's kind of on the outside. Look at that black belly is beautiful, sir.
After that lovely East Coast transplant swam back, we kept pushing upstream, and for the most part, it was relatively quiet outside the occasional missed hook set. This is where I have to admit, road fishing has its advantages. The gravel paralleled the river almost the entire way, so it was just a matter of weaving through the sagebrush and finding a spot in the barbed wire to hop over. This allowed for a lot of flexibility when looking for plan A, plan B, and now on our way to plan C. But before we could jump to the next access spot, we needed some grub.
Poor fire. Yes. We've arrived.
Oh, two cups.
Oh yeah.
Coors on the tailgate and ramen on the road was an S-tier fishing lunch, and that's just a fact. However, looking back, I wish we would have just kept things pushing, because when we arrived at the next spot, you can clearly see that things in the area were changing fast. A nasty wind had started pushing up the valley, carrying what seemed and smelled to be like smoke along with it. Hard to tell through the camera, but the change in scenery was almost night and day different compared to our crisp and clear bluebird morning earlier. This abrupt shift had us both on edge, so we both agreed to not stray all that far from the truck and keep an eye on the horizon. Unknown fires, they are nothing to be ignored. And so we anxiously got down to the water and cracked into the first few holes in and around the bridge. Nick and I, we didn't have much to show. Starting to doubt plan C, this was one of the very rare moments when there was actually a fish where it was supposed to be. This little rainbow, it fought hard and swam back strong, and just from its fins and the color, it looked to be a holdover from previous stockings, but I couldn't be sure. This was, however, a nice addition to the afternoon, but with the wall of smoke only getting thicker, we were both starting to get uneasy about pushing our luck.
Let's call it then.
Okay.
If you want to take a couple whacks with a deeper rig. I mean, I was getting stuck on bottom. Every now and then, so I wasn't like dredging, but
I'm pretty set. Whatever. One last rainbow to end it all.
Game. Because I know, like, if we both stay here fishing this, we're going to be looking over our shoulder the entire time.
With only one mountain pass separating us from civilization, a couple more fish was not worth the cost of potentially getting cut off or worse, trapped by an incoming forest fire. So, in between ashy coughs, we packed up the truck one last time and set our sights back west. Boise was calling our name, and this trip was now officially over. I hope anyone out there watching can understand that more often than not, a fly fishing adventure like this will not go exactly to plan. There will always be slip-ups with research, unknown issues like the fires we found, and hey, at the end of it all, the fish, they might just not be biting. But I gotta say, that is the point of doing anything difficult. If this kind of thing was easy, well, everyone would do it. Nick and I, we had to muster up the patience and perseverance to push through the list of problems we faced once we hit the trail. And thinking on our feet and rolling with the punches, I would say we did a damn fine job of making a nice batch of lemonade out of the lemons thrown our way.
Dude, that is what you come for, man.
Beautiful, man. So beautiful.
Well, howdy folks, if you are seeing this, then that means the video is over. And like always, I just have to say thank you so much for sticking around and watching these videos all the way through. It really means the world that you guys enjoy these videos, and outside of the YouTube algorithm, you know, the whole like, comment, subscribe thing, it's all a racket in my mind. I just like seeing other folks getting stoked on cool fishing adventures. And just because this particular video is over does not mean the adventure is over. We would love to have you around and see you in the next video. And if you can't wait and you're looking for some more fly season action, go check out our other platforms. We got Instagram, Discord, and even a website. And if you're shy about leaving YouTube comments, don't worry. All those other platforms are great places to reach out to me directly so we can kind of talk back and forth, talk shop, so to speak. And if those extra platforms prove to be insufficient, you just can't wait to get on some more fly season content, go check out the Patreon. This is more information-based videos, let's just say. It's a great way to get into the nitty gritty and the exacts of an adventure like this. It's pretty much just me sitting down and talking to you as a friend, what I did, how I did, and more of the why I did, if that makes sense. And it's also an amazing way to support the channel and help these videos kind of go through. And piggybacking off of that, just got to give a quick shout out to the various brands that partner with Fly All Season and help make these adventures possible. You know who you are? Thank you very much. But that is more than enough for me, folks. You know the deal, wherever you find yourself, be it in the Idaho backcountry or in your backyard, I sure hope you keep those feet in the water, and until next time, tight lines.